Everywhere I've turned, somebody has wanted to sacrifice me for my own good. Only they were the ones who benefited.
Olivia, why does Jimmy carry that yellow woman?
In Bessie's room.
Where?
In Bessie's room, you know where.
Hey, what is all that talk going on around here about Bessie?
Mama. I don't know, honey.
Say, what's wrong?
Go to your room, honey.
What?
Don't look at me. I told you not to come up here in the first place.
Well, I guess I'll be going now.
Not yet. You got to see me before you go. You little wretch. Come in my room.
Hey, Jimmy, get this woman off of me.
I can't do you no good, honey.
What are you doing with the
engine? Yeah, y'all can't raise all this sand in here. What's the matter with you?
What's the trouble with you?
Well, look here, I'm the janitor, and I don't want
to... I don't care who you is. I don't care if you're the landlord. You ain't got nothing to do in my business.
You gonna move.
I don't care. Let me move.
You gonna move.
Don't I pay my rent?
Come on now, you gonna move.
Yeah.
Don't you hit me? What's the... Now, yeah. Well, look here. Now, wait a minute, Jeff. Grab the woman.
Jimmy, don't leave me. Jimmy, please don't leave your bestie. Jimmy, you ain't gonna leave me, are you? Woman, I'll be gone before the evening sun goes down. Jimmy, don't I give you everything you say you want?
What have I got?
I give you clothes.
Clothes?
I give you suits.
Suits?
Yeah.
Singular, baby, not plural. One suit, that's all. One suit.
Don't leave me, Jimmy.
Oh, woman, get out of my face.
Jimmy. 1929, this movie classic, St. Louis Blues, starring Bessie Smith, was yet another part of a legacy legitimizing stereotypical images and toxic relationships between Black people. Here we see colorism at its worst when a cheating man demonstrates preference for a lighter-skinned woman over his dark-skinned woman. This woman is then depicted groveling to keep him and him kicking her like a dog. Those images were 90 years ago, and they still persist today. Blackface. Even the show Good Times, seeming to suggest we enjoyed poverty, and eventually, when the main characters eventually left after endless battles over inappropriate scripts and stereotypes, yes, we were being brainwashed into believing this was empowering entertainment when it was just another form of denigration. The only difference now is that we don't just act in these type of productions, we write and produce them.
This is Dr. Michelle, and I want to welcome you to another episode of Tabernacle Talks. And I am so excited today to welcome my guest. Today we're going to be talking a pretty long question, pretty huge question, but I think a pretty important question. Has societal cravings for shock and awe resulted in a decline of cultural sensitivity and pride? And for me to unpack this today, I could not do a topic this big and this controversial without inviting two just wonderful professionals that I've known for some time. First, we have Dr. Barbara Mevin, and we have Dr. Sabrina Harrison-Dean. Welcome to Tabernacle Talks, both of you.
Thank you.
Now, before we get started, I want you each just to kind of tell the audience a little bit about yourself. So, Dr. Mevin, if we can start with you.
Okay. As you said, I'm Dr. Barbara Mevin, and I live in Indianapolis. I have been an educator all of my, my career. In various capacities, starting with English teacher, counselor, IB coordinator, instructional coach, and so on. Currently I'm retired, and I simply it's not so simple, but I just do some online teaching at this time. But I'm very happy to be here and sharing this very interesting topic.
Wonderful. Thanks, Dr. Mevin. Dr. Harrison Dean.
Good afternoon, everyone. I am Dr. Sabrina Harrison Dean, and I have been a registered nurse for more than 25 years. And I am currently in the California area working as a healthcare management executive. And also, prior to COVID, which we're kind of back in a COVID season now, I was in New York and also Texas on the front line fighting COVID, which was a phenomenal experience to be there on the front line, especially in New York. I was there March through June of 2020.
Wow. Well, you're in California. I envy you. So thank you. And I applaud you for being a frontline worker. Now, that's not easy to do during these times. So I applaud you for that. Okay, I think we're gonna jump right in. You know, obviously we're talking about a decline of cultural sensitivity and pride. And I want to start off. There was a research article that I found talking about. The research article was talking about exploitation, cultural appropriation, and degradation. It was written by Shanice Thompson, and she writes, and I want to quote this, from the return of the booty to the growing population of white rappers and the appearance of decidedly urban apparel in high society, it begins to look as though Black culture is increasingly profitable for everyone except Black people. So apparently Black culture is in style and profitable. What are your feelings about what Shanice Thompson is saying? And either of you can just jump in.
Well, I agree with her from the vantage point of there's nothing new under the sun. You know, if you look back in history, you'll see that historically Black people have been exploited by the white culture, you know, historically beginning with slavery and sharecropping and with our talent in the record industry not being paid what they should have been paid, and basically what is exploited is our human vulnerability.
Interesting. Dr. Dean.
I feel what Shanice is saying regarding the booty and BBL, Brazilian butt lift, that's prevalent not only for white Americans, but Black Americans also. White rappers have been around since I was younger. Beastie Boys, Eminem, and Vanilla Ice are just a few that I listened to when I was younger. And then also the urban attire in high society. I mean, I agree with what you're saying. Some of the gentlemen today are wearing suits with sneakers. So at a high society function, they have on a pair of Kohans, which is a brand that is a sneaker that men feel, you know, is more comfortable versus being in a hard sole shoe. So I feel that other races emulate Black, and I've seen it since, you know, I was younger, from skin tanning to we tend to have fuller lips, to the Botox for the lips, and the lips goes on and on and on. So, you know, she's saying that we're not capitalizing. Well, why aren't we? We have brands, so why aren't the brands out there? You know, there's several entrepreneurs, because I'm an entrepreneur also on the side, but why don't the entrepreneurs just rely to be profiled?
Interesting. And I guess, you know, it's interesting that we talk about nothing's new under the sun. Maybe Shanice is just catching up, because I think there's always been an ability to appropriate, and they've been doing it. I do find what's interesting now is the physical appropriation of our actual appearance, which is becoming interesting. You know, Black women have always had full figures, and at some point that was a point of shame. Mm-hmm. Now it's style, and it's now beautiful now because European women are now, like you say, Botoxing and using the Brazilian lifts to capture something that to me is, that's not new under the sun. It's just all of a sudden it's considered culturally okay to be round. And that's interesting to me. Okay, let's go on to Mayor Sadiqu, changes the view a little bit, and they talk about exploitation of our pain. People have made millions, videos, television. In fact, Cops ran for about 31 years. And it wasn't until we had the recent issue with George Floyd and a lot of the protests against police brutality that it kind of disappeared from the airwaves. But there were calls for Cops to be taken off the airwaves for years, and it never happened. The real problem, though, is that this trauma, and I think you talked about that, Dr. Dean, this trauma becomes profitable because our pain has become profitable. Why do you think we bear any responsibility for some of this being on the airwaves?
Yes, I do believe that we bear some of the responsibility because we all have choices. And depending on our choice, there's a consequence. So what gets captured on media is usually a negative consequence of a choice that we have. So I think that we ought to be, you know, mindful of the choices that we make. So the whole world, you know, thrives on this energy, and then because of the negative consequence that's displayed in the media, some people may, you know, stereotype African Americans in one view where that's not reality, even though it's reality TV, but it's not my reality. So everyone is not the same. And we all have different choices, and with those choices comes different consequences.
Okay, Dr. Mebbin.
Well, I think that I agree. The choices we make and have consequences. I think that living in a capitalistic society really enhances, or in the minds of some, gives them permission to maybe make poor choices because I need the money. I can make the money. I think that, you know, we talk a lot about this, but, you know, we fail to sometimes applaud the actors who say, no, I'm not doing that. You know, I think about someone like Cicely Tyson, who never, ever compromised her values. And I think this whole conversation has to do with values and what our values. How do we unpack values? Where is the what we used to call home training? Where do we decide that to do this is prideful, to do that is not? Where do we love ourselves? When do we love ourselves? I see a lot of things that are happening because of capitalism, but because also of a lack of self-love. I also think as society moves forward, so to speak, parents don't want their children to go through, you hear it all the time, well, I don't want my children to go through what I went through. So children become more relaxed and try to believe that they can do what someone else of another color can do. I'll never forget, you know, when I was still teaching, I had a young man. We were during our 1 week of Black History, we were talking about Rosa Parks, and he said to me in all earnestness, but you know, we talked about her not being able to, you know, sit where she wanted to, but he said, but at least she has somewhere to sit. He didn't really understand the significance of what she was doing. And this let me know, and you know, and I didn't scold him because he was earnest, because he didn't know or hadn't been taught our history and the struggles that we've had. So I see a lot of this coming from, you know, this whole spectrum that we're talking about today is, you can do anything you want, but we don't talk about the responsibility that comes with doing certain things. And I think the key word here is responsibility. How do you unpack values? How do you unpack pride? I didn't mean to go on so long, but.
That's okay. Well, it's interesting because when you talk about this attack, not just on us physically, psychologically, we're now starting to see even Black love being portrayed in very negative ways on reality TV. And I'm particularly thinking about the role of Black men, how they are characterized in many of these mainstream reality shows as not valuing Black women, and instead are valuing every gender, every nationality under the sun, except Black women. And I guess, how do you see that as a blatant, affront? Do you see that as people are simply able to choose and do what they want to do? And do you find that these relationships are balanced? I'll start with you, Sabrina. What do you see?
Well, first, I feel that, as I said before, everyone has a choice. So, you know, it's your prerogative, as Mike Brown would say. You know, whatever you want to do, you know, it's totally up to you. However, just know that everyone doesn't feel that way. Some people feel because you're an African-American woman that you could marry an African-American man. So, if you choose to do otherwise, just know that, unfortunately, you may come across some hard times, or you have to develop some thick skin because other people may voice their opinion. So that's just something that I believe, you know, comes with that. But everyone has their own, you know, their own choice. Okay?
Dr. Mabin.
Well, I think it depends on, you know, which lens you want to look at that through. You know, you could say that it's the Black man's quest or search to be like the white man, to have a white woman. You could say, you know, because I'm sure we all know couples who, you know, interracial couples that people marry or date who they fall in love with. You know, we've all heard love has no color. So I think it is a matter of, do I feel like being the angry Black woman today and saying, well, you know, because I'm Black, no one wants me or wants to date me or marry me? Or, you know, there has been controversy too, with our race about colorism. You know, if you can't get a white woman, then you want the lightest Black woman that you can get. You know, so it depends on, for me, it depends on the perspective that I wish to pursue at any given time. But when I see these stars or celebrities seeming to, be addicted to just one thing or one type, then I do question what psychological barriers or desires are in their hearts or in their heads. What have they been taught? Are they still living under the guise of, if it's white, it must be right, you know? Or are they simply following their hearts? So it's again, like Dr. Dean said, it's about choice. But I think people have to unpack within themselves, why do I make these choices?
Interesting. Yeah, I know I did research for another project that I was working on, and I think it was interesting research that said it's not that Black women are angry about these biracial relationships. We're not. I think the anger comes from being characterized that we are mean, being characterized that we are unlovable. And it's those characterizations where the anger comes from, or that we're not worthy. I'm like Dr. Dean, your choice of who you choose to fall in love with is your choice. But don't turn around and then mischaracterize that the reason I chose is because Black women do X, Y, Z. Right. Then I think that feeds into the stereotype. And I think that's what makes toxic relationships. in our community. Okay. On just about every episode of, I don't know if you guys watch some of the television shows with these reunion shows, but I guess you start to see a pattern that it's okay to fight on television now. It's okay to be bleeped every other word now, because you clearly know from their mouth what they're saying. So I don't even know that the bleep is really even effective. And I guess what's troubling is we all know reality TV really isn't real. A lot of that is scripted. So the actors themselves actually know in advance what they're being asked to do and what's going to be filmed. Does that make it worse that it's scripted? I'll start with you, Dr. Mevin. Does it make it worse?
Yes, because for me, it makes it worse. I don't really watch those shows. You know, that's one of the... You know, I'm not a big television watcher. I'm a reader. And I do like PBS and, you know, some shows. But, you know, I remember when Jerry Springer first came on. That was one of the, and remains, if it's still on, one of the shows that I absolutely refused to watch because it was scripted. And, you know, at that time, it was mostly people of color making absolute fools of themselves for, I don't know what the money amount was, but was it really worth it? So for me, yes, it makes it worse to know that I'm going to go in and act like this for money. And no one seems to be, you know, I know I'm dating myself, but you always had in the back of your mind, what would my mom think? What would my dad think? And I don't see that.
I know there used to be a time where you would actually go in shadow and you wouldn't show your face. But now people will go on Maury and say, who's the dad? Who's the father of my baby? And it could be five choices and they show their faces. There is no shame in doing that. Dr. Dean, what are your comments?
I agree also that it does make it worse. And where reality TV, as you said, reality TV isn't my reality.
That's a very good point.
Reality TV, it's a more of a facade. And some people, you know, can differentiate between real and this is, you know, real and fake, or, you know, it being a facade. That's not real, even though it's called reality TV. But to dig a little bit even further, what bothers me are the producers, some of the producers. So Mona Scott King, she's a Black woman.
Yes.
That's writing scripts for the other Black teachers to say, as well as Sonny O'Neill, who is a Black woman, for Basketball Wise, and the script that she writes. And you see the fights, et cetera, if you watch that show, that series. So why is that? Why? They're capitalizing off of it, but do I agree with it? No. And I think it starts with the people that are being it, even though, yes, it's about money for them, I would assume. But as Dr. Mevin said, where are your values? You know, okay, I understand you're trying to rise, et cetera, but where are your values? There's, you know, there's things that, you know, you're not just going to do everything, but some people do.
I think you make an excellent point that I think it gives the executive producers cover when I can say that I have a Black producer writing this. So
exactly.
You can't hold me accountable for those negative stereotypes or imagery because I didn't write it. You know, your people are writing this about your people.
About you, yeah.
I think that's what's shameful. I think that's what's so shameful about it. Absolutely. Okay, I don't, VH1, I'm picking on all the major ones here. The Bobby and Whitney reality show that came on. I am a diehard Whitney Houston fan. And I think anyone who knows Whitney pre-drug problem Whitney knows that what we saw on VH1 was not the Whitney Houston that many of us saw. And I think that was once again... she was being exploited. Her pain was being exploited. Her trauma was being exploited. Her addiction was being exploited. Mm-hmm. And I remember one of the actual segments where Bobby is actually talking about how he has to help her in the bathroom with her bathroom hygiene. And for anyone to know how iconic Whitney Houston was to actually be placed in a position where Bobby is now saying, you know, basically I have to help her in the bathroom. And the show, when it was canceled, it's because she didn't want to do it anymore. It wasn't because we weren't watching this downward spiral. What do you feel about the people? I mean, we all know who her producer was, made millions and millions of dollars off of her not being a better handler and making sure that we didn't see such an iconic fall. What responsibility do they have, or do they have any responsibility at all?
Well, you know, again, I've never seen that show, but just your description lets me know that, as I said earlier, they were exploiting her vulnerability, her addiction, you know, whatever. They were taking advantage of that, and I don't feel as if her handlers, again, going back to the capitalistic society, feel any responsibility other than how much money can I make from this. That is what they feel responsible for. If I've not made X amount of dollars, then this wasn't any good. Or she and or Bobby were of no use for me. I don't see people who show our vulnerability as a people showing it to heal us. They're showing it to still sell us, as they all have always done. History tells us that we were brought here to be sold.
Wow. Powerful comment, Dr. Mebbin.